Ulrich Rao algebra of hyperplane arrangements. So these series of lecture, what Din Van Lee is going to offer is going to be jointly taught by Din and Tim Romer. So initially we are going to have three lectures on polyhedral geometry up to symmetry by Din. And the last lecture is going to be delivered by Tim Romer, where he will definitely, Din and Tim will open some projects toward the end of this particular topic. And this is a newly evolving area where people are studying the structure up to symmetry. And this is, okay, from the title of the first lecture, it seems to be that he's going to introduce it completely combinatorically point of view. Over to you, Din. Welcome to the Simpa School.
Yeah, okay. So thanks a lot, Imran. Thanks for the nice introduction and then for the invitation. Okay, so yeah, let me see. So I couldn't move. Okay, good. Now I can move the slide. Good. Okay, so I mean the idea of our lecture is to provide you some very basic notion and reason in the polyhedral geometry together with some new research direction and new reason that are extension of classical reason in the polyhedral geometry to the infinite dimensional case. Okay, so as Imran mentioned already, I will give the first three lecture on basic steps, and Professor Tim Romer will give the last one on the, yeah, some recent research, and yeah, maybe also some open problems. Good. So today for the lecture today, I will give a quick introduction to polyhedra and to important subset. Yeah, two important subset of polyhedra, namely polytopes and cones. Good. So I can still. Good. Okay. So let me first. Give you some motivation for the study of polyhedra. Yeah, so maybe you encounter polyhedra already in your undergraduate lecture. Yeah, so for example, in linear programming, polyhedra appears at the feasible set of linear programming problems. Yeah, so for example, so here I have a very simple linear programming problem. So you have to minimize this object function subject to these three constraints. So here each constraint is a half space. This is given by a linear inequality, right? So it constraint define a half space. So if you take the intersection of these three half space, you get a polyhedra. And then to minimize this this function, yeah, so in this particular case, you can just draw the line 2x plus y equal to c. And then you reduce c until you meet the last point of the polyhedra. Yeah, so the last point of the polyhedra that's still in the point where the line 2x plus y equal to c still intersects the feasible set. This is a vertex of the polyhedra, and this is the place where where the object function attain its minimality. Good. Yeah, so that is the first motivation for studying polyhedra. Other motivation is that there are very nice reason about polyhedra. Yeah, so one good example is the Euler formula. So Euler discovered a very nice and somehow surprising relationship between the number of vertices, the number of edges, and the number of faces of a three-dimensional polytope. So if you take any three-dimensional polytope and you count the number of vertices, you subtract the number of edges, and you add the number of faces, then you always get the result is its own way true. So it is somehow very surprising formula, very simple, but it is home for any three-dimensional polytope. Yeah, so you can check, for example, you can check this for a cube here, so then you see that a cube has the 8 vertices, right? 12 edges and 6 faces, and then you take 8 minus 12 plus 6, then you get 2. So so this is a very nice result, and so now this result is considered as one of the starting point for algebraic geometry. Another nice and elementary result is big theorem. So this is a result about lattice polygon. Yeah, lattice means that the vertices of this polygon the vertices of this polygon have integral components. So every vertices of this polygon are integral vertices in the ring plane. And here we have a simple formula for the area of this lattice polygon. So the area of this lattice polygon P is given by this formula. This is equal to IP plus half of BP minus 1, where IP is the number of integral lattice points of P, and BP is the number of lattice points on the boundary of P. So for example, if you consider this polygon, then you count the integral lattice points. So here in this example, there are 14 integral lattice points. Yeah, so you see 14. And on the boundary of this polygon, so this is a pentagon, it has 5 vertices and also 3 other boundary lattice points. Yeah, so then we have a very easy way to compute the area of this polygon. So this is 14 plus 8 over 2 minus 1, so you get 17. Yeah, rather surprising result that you can compute the area of a polygon just by counting points of some special type. Yeah, so this is another interesting about lattice about polyhedra. Yeah, so So that are some motivation to show you that polyhedra are really interesting and they deserve further study. Good. Okay. So now let me, because I mean we do not know the background of the participants. So we decide to give we decide to introduce everything from the very basic level. So okay, so let me
just one question regarding to this previous in boundary point. You mean excluding the vertices A, B, F, G, H?
So A, B, F, G, H are boundary lattice points. So here I mean boundary means that the lattice points that are on the edges of the polygon. So interior points mean so here I mean in interior in the sense not normal topology, right? So it is really in the interior of this set. So all the vertices of this polygon are on the boundary. So here you count these five vertices together with these three other boundary.
Okay. Thank
you. Thanks for the question. Good. Let me introduce. So I mean, from the very beginning, very basic notion. So what a polyhedron is. So we call a polyhedron a subset of R to the n, which is the intersection of finitely many closed half spaces in R to the n. Remember that a closed half space is given by a linear inequality, right? So then in terms of algebraic terms, in terms of algebraic notion, then a polyhedron is nothing but a subset of R to the n that is given by a system of linear inequality. So a polyhedron. You can define polyhedron by m by n matrix A together with a vector B, and P polyhedron P is the set of all vector X which satisfy this system of linear inequality AX smaller or equal to B. So we call the dimension of a polyhedron the dimension of it alpha hun. I guess you know this notion alpha hun from alpha geometry already, right? So the alpha hun of P is defined to be the set of all alpha combination of the element of P. So here there's a sum of alpha I ui. This is a alpha combination. So here alpha I is a real number, and the sum of this alpha I should be one. So this is a alpha subspace of R to the n, and we define the dimension of P. This is the dimension of this alpha hun. During the talk, if something unclear, then just interrupt me. We are mostly interested in the two special types of polyhedra. So the first one is the first one, polytopes. So a polytope is just, nothing but a bounded polyhedron. So here, I mean, bounded, this is again the, with respect to the normal topology in R to the N. So bounded means that the polyhedron is contained in some bone, right? So there exists some bone that contain the polyhedron. So here are two examples of polytopes. So the first one is a tetrahedron, and the second one is an octahedron. Another type of polyhedron that we will mainly consider cone. So okay, so a cone by definition, this is an intersection of closed linear half space of R to the N. Yeah, so I mean here linear means that the half space is defined by a homogeneous linear inequality. Yeah, and we say that the cone is polyhedral if it is the intersection of finitely many half spaces. So okay, so then like in the definition of a polyhedra, definition of a polyhedron, then a cone is a polyhedral cone if it can be given by a set of linear inequality. Yeah, so yeah, it just means that the vector b in the definition of the polyhedron is the zero vector. So here on the linear inequality are homogeneous. So the constant coefficient should be zero. Yeah. Okay, so the obvious example of a cone, yeah, for example, this is the non-negative orton. So here the non-negative orton of R to the N, it is the set of all the points where the coordinates are non-zero, right? So that is one example of cone. And yeah, in another example, you can see a three-dimensional cone. Yeah, so imagine that for this one, imagine that you have a pentagon, and you have a pentagon, and you connect every point of you consider the ray that connect every point of the pentagon with the origin. Yeah, so you get a cone. Ah, okay. So, oh, sorry. I see some question in the chat. Okay. So that is first one. This is a very interesting question. Is possible to extend peak theorem to three-dimensional space and obtain an analog formula for volume of the resulting figure? Yeah, that is a very interesting question. So we will come back to this question in my third lecture. So in my third lecture, when we discuss elastic polytope, we will revisit peak theorem, and the answer, quick answer is that yes, one can extend the quick theorem to not only three-dimensional space, but also to any finite dimensional space. And the second question is that in the definition of a polyhedra, it is not necessary to put a restriction on M. You have a half space. If we work, we take M equal to 1, we only have a half space of. No, in the definition of a polyhedra, there's no restriction on the number of inequality. So the number of inequality, so it can be 1 or 2 or 1,000 or 1 million. So it is there's no restriction on the number of inequality. So if M is smaller than the dimension of the ambient space, so for example, if you only have one inequality, then you have a half space and
we can take
this question toward the end. You may continue. Yeah. Okay. So what can we, the vertexes in case okay, so then to define the vertexes of a polyhedra, then a vertex of a polyhedron is a face of the polyhedron that that has dimension 0. So then you have to define what is a face of a polyhedron and what is a vertex is that a vertex is that a face of a polyhedron that has dimension 0. So for example, if you have only one inequality, then in that case you have no vertexes. Yeah, so a polyhedron may have no vertexes, but that does not happen for a polytope. A polytope always have vertexes. Yes. Okay. So let me continue. So maybe you will see some definition later. Good. Okay. So then to characterize polyhedron, we need some further notion. Yeah. So here we have the notion of a convex and a conical set. Yeah, I guess that some of you may know already this notion, but yeah, anyhow, I briefly review it here. Okay, so a subset C of R to the N is convex if for any two points X, Y, and C, the segment connecting X and Y is contained in C. Yeah, so here the segment connecting X and Y is the set of own convex combination of X and Y. So a convex combination of X and Y is an element of this form lambda X plus 1 minus lambda Y, where lambda is an element in the interval from 0 to 1. Yeah, so that's the definition of the segment that connect X and Y, as you can imagine from its geometric interpretation. Yeah. Okay, so I have an example of a convex set. So here you have the set in the blue is the convex set, while the purple set here is non-convex, because here you see that you have two points x and y in this subset where their connection does not contain in this given subset. Yeah. And okay, and subset C is conical if all non-negative combination of x and y belong to C. So if you take all the non-negative combination of x and y, you get again an element of C. So okay, so here for example, this this gray domain, this is a conical set. Good. And okay, so then here are some remark and example. So from the definition, you see that any conical sets are convex, because any convex, by definition, any convex combination is a conical combination, right? Because for a convex combination here, lambda belong to the set from 0 to 1. So lambda and 1 minus lambda are both non-zero. So then this means that any convex combination, this is also a conical combination. So any conical set are convex. And from the definition, you see immediately that the intersection of convex sets is again convex. And similarly, intersection of conical sets is again conical. Good. And half spaces are convex. Yeah, because half space is defined by a linear inequality, right? So you check easily that if you take two points in a half space and you connect them, then the segment that connects that two points still contain in the given half space. Good. And linear half space are conical set. Yeah, so that is also easy to see. Now a polyhedron is an intersection of half spaces. So a polyhedron is a convex set. And similarly, a cone is an intersection of a linear half space, and each linear half space is a conical set. So cones are conical sets. Right? So that are some easy consequence of the definition. Good. So because the intersection of convex sets is again convex, and intersection of conical sets is again conical. So then you can define convex Hund and conical Hund of a subset of R to the n. So by definition, the convex Hund of a subset X is the intersection of all the convex sets that contain X. So the convex Hund of X is by this definition, this is the smallest convex set that contain X. And similarly, the convex Hund of X is the intersection of all the conical set containing X. So this is again the smallest conical set that contain x, right? So that I guess that's the you have a similar definition in undergraduate course. Yeah, so for example, you define so for example, affine hand, this is also can also be defined in this way, right? Affine hand or the vector space generated by a subset. Yeah, so that are some similar way to define the Hund of the subset with respect to some property. So you just take the intersection on the set with the given property that contain a given subset, and then you get in this way. So here we have a simple lemma to describe the convex Hund and the conical Hund of a given subset of R to the n. The convex Hund of X is nothing but the set of all the convex combination of the element of X. Yeah, so here a convex combination is a sum in this form where lambda I are non-zero and their sum is equal to one. And similarly, the conical Hund of X is nothing but the set of all conical combination of the element of X. So here the sum runs over all the lambda I, where lambda I are non-negative. I think that the proof of this Poisson is not so difficult, and I left it as an exercise for you. Yeah, so let me give some example of convex Hund and conical Hund. So okay, so for example, if you take a finite set in R2, then the convex Hund is nothing but a polyhedron, but a polygon, right? So this is that is somehow easy to see, and the conical Hund of X is a cone. Yeah, so you can just connect every point in the given set with the origin, and then you see that the conical Hund is nothing but a cone with somehow. In the general situation, you get a two-dimensional cone.
Professor?
Sorry.
So in your previous slide, I mean the previous one.
Yeah, this one.
What is K here? I was wondering.
Sorry.
I mean in the lemma where you have defined the cone, what is K here?
K thanks. So K here is any non-negative integer. So K here is not a fixed number. So I should write here. Yeah, thanks for the question. So here K is a non-negative number, a non-negative integer. So this is a running number. It is not a fixed one, so you can take any finite subset of X. So you want to UK, this is a finite subset of X, and you take the convex combination or conical combination of X.
So, I got it. Thank you.
So I think that the proof of this one is rather natural, right? So you saw that the set on the right hand side is convex or conical, so it should contain it contains x. So then you get immediately one inclusion, and I guess the other inclusion is just also easy. So yeah, I left this as an exercise. Okay. So let's continue with some example of convex horn and conical horn. So okay, so here I take the standard basis of R to the n plus one. Yeah, so E1 to En plus one. So this is the canonical basis for R to the n plus one, and you take the conical horn of you take the convex horn of this canonical basis vector, then you see that this is a polytope. This is a polytope. So for example, here a tetrahedron. This is a so when n equal to two, then you n equal to two. So n equal to two, then you get n equal to two. When n equal to two, then you when n equal to two, then you get a triangle, right? N equal to two, then you get a triangle, and when equal to three, then you get a tetrahedron. So this is a polytope, because so here you can describe. You can describe this convex horn by a set of inequality, right? By a set of linear inequality. So so this is exactly the subset of all the element x in R to the n plus one, such that the coordinates are non-negative and their sum is equal to one. So this polytope plays an important role in probability theory. So in probability theory, you know that whenever you have a model, then the sum of the probability of all the event on the elementary events is equal to one, right? So this polytope is this is yeah. So somehow this polytope is a model for probability spaces. Another example of convex horn is that if you take this set A, which is subset of R to the n, where whose element, so the coordinate of each element of A is either zero or one. So then you have two to the n So this set consists of two Gn elements, right? And then you take the convex Hund of this subset. Yeah, so then you have a, then you get a Q, right? So yeah, so when n, you can imagine that when n equal to 2, then you get a square, and when n equal to 3, then you get a unit cube. So this is again a polytope, because this can be described by this inequality. So xi is bigger or equal to 0 and smaller or equal to 1. Okay, so here's another question on the simplex. Xi belong to so here x the coordinate of x is x1 to n plus 1. So xi is not an element. So xi is a coordinate of x. Xi does not belong to n plus 1. Xi belong to r. So yes, so I should write it more clearly. So here x is an element of r to the n plus 1, whose coordinate are x1 to xn plus 1. So yeah, so you see that imagine that you so you are working in the two dimensional or three dimensional spaces, then so when you are in two dimensional spaces, and then two dimensional spaces, and then you get a triangle or a tetrahedron. Good. Another important example is the cross polytope. So here you take the unit vector and then negative. Yeah. So e1 minus e1, e2 minus e2, and then en minus en, and then you take the convex Hund of those vector. Then you get again a polytope, and this is called the n-dimensional cross polytope. So I mean this convex Hund can also be described by a set of linear inequality, right? So here is the sum of absolute value of all the coordinates of this element smaller or equal to 1. So here this is a picture for a three-dimensional cross polytope, right? So for two-dimensional, then you get a square, right? So where the vertices are e1 minus e1, e2 minus e2. This is a cross polytope in three-dimensional vector space. Good. Okay. So far, another example is the non-negative octant. So the non-negative octant, so you can write it as the conical Hund of the standard basis vector, or you can also write it as a convex Hund of the non-negative rise, right? So this is another simple example. Good. Okay. So so far you see that every every conical hand or convex hand is a polytope or a cone, right? And that is not a cosine. That is they are illustration for a very important reason in polyhedral geometry. So this might be one of the first fundamental reason in the polyhedral geometry. So okay, so it characterized polytope and cone in terms of convex and conical set. So it say that so it has the two version, one version for polytope, and for polytope it say that a polytope is nothing but a convex hand of a finite subset of R to the n, and for cone it is say that a polyhedral cone is nothing but the conical hand of a finite subset of R to the n. The version for cone here sometimes also it is stated in the form that a cone is a polyhedra if and only it is finitely generated. And for polytope we have a similar statement. A polytope is a finite generated polyhedra for polyhedron. So this is a fundamental reason in polyhedra. Let me mention why is this important and useful. For example, we saw already that the feasible set of a linear program is a polyhedron, the feasible set is given by an intersection of a linear the intersection of half spaces, right? So this is a polyhedron. But on the other hand, a possible solution to this linear program is a vertex of that polyhedron. The Minkowski white theorem gives us two description of a polyhedron. That is somehow this is very useful for linear programming. Okay. So here's another important another aspect of why Minkowski theorem is that it is it a bit characterization has its advantages. So from the second characterization, the characterization, the finitely generated characterization, you can easily prove that the Minkowski sum of two polytope or Minkowski sum of two cone is again a polytope or a cone. But I mean, if you use the definition, if you use the definition of a polytope as an intersection of half space, then I think that this statement is very non-trivial, right? So this is not easy to prove. directly by using the definition that the Minkowski sum of two polytopes is a grain of polytope. On the other hand, if you use the definition, then you see that the intersection of two polytope or two cone is again a polytope and a cone, right? And this statement, I mean this easy statement is difficult to prove if you use the other characterization. If you use the characterization in terms of convex Hund or conical Hund, then this statement is not easy to see. Okay, and I will provide the proof of this important theorem in the next lecture. So this is rather non-trivial, and I will provide it tomorrow. Okay, so then for today, I think I will mention another important theorem. So this is the Caratteri-Dori theorem. So again, it has two versions, one version for polytopes and one version for cone. So it says that if you have a polytope and if you take an element in the polytope, then this element X can be written as a convex combination of at most n plus one element of P. So here n is the dimension of the ambient space. So any element of P can be written as a convex combination n plus one element P. So imagine that you have a square and you take an element in the square, right? If you have a square and take an element in the square, then that element will belong to one of the two triangles. So if you divide the square by a diagonal, then a given point in the square must belong to one of the two triangles defined by our diagonal, right? So so this is somehow this reason is easy to imagine, right? So and for cone we have a similar statement. If you have a cone and you take an element in the cone, then it is a conical combination of at most n element in the cone, where n is the dimension of the ambient space. I mean the proof is also rather simple, but I guess the time is not
time is up now
so I mean maybe you can take this as an exercise. And I just want to mention that the Caratteri-Dori theorem is simple, but it has some other interesting consequence. Yeah, so there are Radon and Hilly theorem, and in fact these three theorems are foundational reason of convex geometry. I left the proof of this theorem as the exercise, because they can follow rather easily from Caratteri-Dori theorem. Okay, so then to conclude the lecture, so let me just mention some Let me just summarize what we have done today. So, okay, so then polyhedra are very interesting geometric objects. Yeah, so they appear in a certain area of mass. Okay, so then we have at least two ways to describe polytopes and cone, yeah, either in terms of inequality or in terms of convex hand or conical hand. And finally, we also mentioned Caro-Theodori theorem, which is simple and powerful. Okay, so let me stop here. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Dean. Okay, I think you already answered many questions which were in the chat. Are there other questions? So thus, there is a request from my side. May you please share these slides with me so that I can place it on the website for the participant. And maybe after reading those, they can come up with some questions which can be answered later on.
Sure.
So send it to me, okay, afterward. Okay, any questions from the audience at the moment? Yeah, Sadia, go ahead. There is a question.
Thank you, Professor, for such a nice talk. My question is related to Minkowski sum. For example, if we want to find the Minkowski sum of circle and a triangle, how can we see it?
In fact, I was just thinking about the same, whether the ambient space of P and Q should be the same.
So let me sorry. Yeah, so okay, so here you see from the definition. So here you can add x and y here x and y should be in the same ambient space, right? X and y should be in the same ambient space. So P and Q should be a subset of the same ambient space. Okay, so let's come to your question. So if you have a triangle and a circle, right? A triangle and a circle. So so then I should imagine that at each point of the triangle, you take a circle. So if you add one point with a circle, if you add one point with a circle, then you get a circle. So is this that this is that this is so you just move a circle to a new center. So can you imagine that? So if you add one point with a circle, then you get a circle. It means that you move the circle to another center, right? So the imagine that you have a circle at the origin, and you add that circle with another point, then you just move the circle to the new origin. To the new center. So the new center is exactly the point that you add to the circle. And now, if you have a triangle, then you do the same thing for every point in the triangle. Yeah. So then it means that the Minkowski sum of a triangle and a circle is that the union of all the circle that center at the point in the triangle. So you can imagine that Yeah, so
can you draw the picture just to give an idea how the things are going for? Yeah.
So I don't know how to draw it.
Try this pencil. Annotate. Just upstairs. Take the cursor up.
Where is this now?
More up. Yeah. View options. Just click the view options in the top.
Let me.
Yeah.
Maybe it's here, right?
Ding, maybe you take a circle or in the line which you add. It's maybe easier to visualize.
Where is this? Let me. So maybe a circle and a line is easier to. Yeah. Thanks, Tim. So okay. So now, if you have a circle, right? You have a circle. So okay. So I for simplicity, I assume that the center of this circle is the origin, right? Okay. So this is the origin. So now, if you add this circle with 1 point here, 1 point in on the line. So this is nothing but you move the circle. But you move the center of this circle to from the origin to this point, yeah. So then imagine that now you take the circle of everything like this, and at every point you have a circle. So then the result is nothing but this one, right?
So
So you have a strip between two lines, right?
Yeah.
So then for a triangle, then I guess that is something like this.
Yeah.
Something like this. So this should be smooth here. This is not a point, but it should be smooth. Right. So something like that.
Thank you, Sadi, for the question. Any other question from anyone else? Oh, if this is the case, let's thank Din once again. Thank you, Din. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, please share this.